Good morning, everyone. Great to see you all here this morning. Sorry about the rain. I'm just thankful it didn't rain on our outdoor service the other week, but the Lord is good. The Lord is faithful. I'm glad to be here in the Lord's house with all of you today. I just want to add my encouragement and excitement to the announcement that Mike shared with us about next weekend for the kickoff of our ministry season. It's going to be an amazing weekend here at church, and I can't wait to start the new series, Just Jesus, Come and See. Talked a lot about his leaders. Where should we go in the Word in the middle of what we've been going through as a church family? We said we got to get to Jesus. We just got to get to Jesus. We get to Jesus. If everyone gets closer to Jesus, everyone's going to be okay. And so we're going, Just Jesus, Come and See. So get here, get your Bibles ready. We'll be in the book of Mark. And then I'm really also excited about being able to share some future vision with you all. Our leaders, our pastors, our campus pastors, our church leadership team have been working really, really hard. Lots of prayer, lots of meetings. What is the future of our church going to look like? What's it going to be like? What's the pulpit going to be like? What are our priorities? What is the future structure of our leadership going to be? This was all the current leadership is all temporary because of things that have happened in the past. Where are we going to go? And so make sure you get here next week and we're going to find out all about that. So prioritize it and we'll see you next Sunday. But I am also super excited to be here sharing God's word today. We're going to be in the book of 2 Samuel. And Chandler and Joey. Jerry and George. Cap and Tony. Woody and Buzz. And now a little girl power. Laverne and Shirley, and for some of you old-timers, Lucy and Ethel. There's something alluring, something attractive to all of us when the idea of friendship is portrayed to us. This, I can be myself no matter what friend. And it's worth shelling out $15 to go to the movie and get some popcorn. It's worth a must-see TV day on the couch with a bowl of ice cream to binge-watch Friends. There's something special that God has placed a desire in all of us to have friendships where everyone knows your name, or when we say to each other, I'll be there for you, and you'll be there for me too. The Bible has lots of great examples of friendships, dynamic duos in the Bible. Let's just take some time to name some of them. What are some of the famous friendships, famous duos in the Bible? Yell them out. All right, what was that? David and Jonathan, that's what we're going to be today. That's probably the best example. What else? Barnabas and Saul. Good. What else? About Moses and Aaron? How about Ruth and Naomi? So there's lots of what? I couldn't hear you. You Joshua and Caleb? Yeah, good. We're going to look at probably the best example today of friendship. It's going to set up where we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 9, and that's David and Jonathan. I'm just going to quickly review kind of that relationship and how it came to be. If you remember, if you look back in the book of 1 Samuel, you will find that the nation of Israel wanted a king like all the other nations. God was not pleased with it because God said, I am your king, but the people wanted a king. And God said, like he often does when we want things that aren't good for us, he basically says, okay, I'll let you do it. And so God allows them to have a king, and God actually chooses the king. And that king's name was Saul. And Saul was a tall, dark, handsome man that they could all look to. And he looked the part of a king. Kind of reminds me of a guy like Mike Ruge. The way he was tall. Stand up, Mike. Tall, dark, handsome. That's what Saul looked like. So God appoints Saul. And Saul starts out well, but he doesn't finish well at all. He begins to make some ungodly choices. And because of that, God takes his spirit off of Saul, and he tells Samuel, the prophet, to go to a place called Bethlehem, where he is going to choose and where Samuel will anoint the future king of Israel. And his name was David, a little shepherd boy. As Saul continues to go deeper into his ungodliness, after he's anointed, David, by providence, goes to the battlefront to see his brothers, and there's a man named Goliath taunting the nation of Israel, and David, through the power of God, slays the giant. After he slays the giant, Saul won't let him go back home. Saul invites him basically into his house, the royal palace, as one of his own, allows him to eat at his table. But as he's there in the house of Saul, his fame, David's fame, continues to grow, and Saul becomes jealous. It says in the Bible that as soon as David came into the house, Jonathan, Saul's son, the future heir to the throne, his heart became knit with David's, and he loved him as his own soul. And David and Jonathan begin a friendship that's a great example to us all. Saul's ire continues to rage against David, and David wants to make sure, so he asked Jonathan to ask a question of his dad, and how he responds would tell them both where Saul's heart was towards David. And Jonathan brings it up. Saul gets angry and actually throws a spear to try to kill Jonathan because of what he talked about with David. So now David is going to leave, but before they leave, the two friends gather together. And if you got your Bibles, just go over to 1 Samuel. Let me see exactly where it is. I want you to all look at it with me. 1 Samuel chapter 20. Verse 14 and 15. Sadly, David is going to now go into exile because Saul is after his life. And David and Jonathan gather together, and in their last interaction, Jonathan says, verse 14 of chapter 20, "If I am still alive, show me the steadfast love of the Lord that I may not die." And then verse 15, that's going to set up where we're going to be today. "And do not cut off your steadfast love from my house forever, when the Lord cuts off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth." What Jonathan says is, "Remember my descendants and love them like you love me." We're going to see today that King David makes good on this promise of kindness. It's probably one of the greatest acts of kindness in all of the scriptures. But more importantly, what we're going to see is that David's act of kindness is simply an illustration of the, not King David, but the King of Kings' kindness towards all of us. So the title of our sermon today is simply "The Kindness of God." And we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 9, so you can flip over there now. 2 Samuel chapter 9. The first point of our sermon today, of our message, is the kindness of God is available to me no matter where I am. The kindness of God is available to me no matter where I am. 2 Samuel verse chapter 9, verse 1. The title of it for me says, "David's kindness to Mephibosheth." I'm going to have a hard time with that name, but let's get it out there now. I might call him like five different names. Maybe we'll call him Meph for short. David's kindness to Mephibosheth. "And David said, 'Is there still anyone left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?'" See, he remembers. This is like probably, we believe, about 25 to 30 years later than that scene we just had with Jonathan and Saul. It's still on his heart. "Now there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba. And they called him to David. And the king said to him, 'Are you Ziba?' And he said, 'I am your servant.' And the king said, Is there not still someone of the house of Saul that I may show kindness of God to him? Ziba said to the king, there is still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in his feet. The king said to him, where is he? And Ziba said to the king, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, at Lodabar. Then King David sent and brought him from the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, at Lodabar. Again, our first point is the kindness of God is available to me no matter where I am. The warring for David has a temporary cease. He subdued his enemies of the time. There's going to be more coming, but right now there's peace. And David now can rest, and where does his heart go? His heart goes back to the commitment that he made to his best friend. Who in the house of Saul can I show kindness to? I love it. A friend keeps his commitment no matter how long it takes. He's seeking to show kindness. He's initiating it. The word kindness there, I underlined it in my Bible. It's not like the kindness like when you're driving on like a construction area and there's two lanes and there's a third one, but it's closing to just go to two. And here comes these people zooming by the long line and you're right there and they come up front and that kindness would be to just stop and let them go in and smile about it. How many of you can do that? It's not very easy, is it? We're not talking about kindness like that. I hope that's not the only thing you get out of your sermon that you're going to let people in like at the merge, but we're not talking about kindness like that. The word, the Hebrew word here is hesed, and the word hesed means covenantal loyalty and love, faithfulness and goodness. So he wants to show that kind of loyalty and love towards Jonathan, and he asks, is there anyone left? He asked Ziba, who was a minister in the house of Saul before he had died. Is there anyone left? Well, there is. There's one person left. But he's not in Jerusalem. Look at verse 4. The king said to him, where is he? And Ziba said to the king, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, at Lodabar. Then the king David sent and brought him from the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, at Lodabar. He's at this place called Lodabar. Scholars believe that Lodabar was on the east side of the Jordan, out in the barren wilderness of eastern Israel. Now, I've been there, actually. My wife and I went to Israel in November, and I've been to this part of that area, and I'm telling you, it's desolate, it's deserted, it's dry. It's not the kind of place that you want to go. But unfortunately, it's the kind of place where people have to go when they're in trouble and running away. The Hebrew word actually for Lodabar literally means no pasture, no word, without a place to feed. Lodabar is like a town for exiles, outcasts, and the forgotten. Far from the courts of Saul and Jonathan's royal house in Jerusalem. Why is Mephibosheth there? He's there because on the day that his grandfather Saul and his dad Jonathan get killed in the battle against the Philistines at Gilboa, they both are killed. The Philistines are going to come in and take over. And every member of the house of a conquered king is in trouble. And so a nurse grabs Mephibosheth and they flee. He was 5 years old. We're going to learn later that at this time, he's probably guessing he has a son at this time, Mephibosheth. So he's probably 25, 30. For 25 years, he's in Lodabar. Show the picture again. Imagine a few shanties in the middle of that. By no fault of his own, the 5-year little boy has to live in Lodabar with his nurse. Could you imagine what little Mephibosheth would have been thinking? What happened? Why am I here? Did I do something wrong? I used to eat grapes and pomegranates in my grandfather's and my father's house. Now all I eat is dust. Why am I here? I didn't do anything. All of us at one time or another find ourselves in Lodabar. How did I get here? You may be there now. Through no fault of your own, you find yourself in the wilderness where the circumstances in your life are outside of your own control and they've delivered you to a desolate place. Maybe you were abused as a child. Maybe you were let go because there were cutbacks at work. Maybe you're battling heart disease or cancer because it runs in your family. Maybe you are in a hard divorce with no desire of your own. Maybe someone lied about you at school, hurting your reputation and causing you to lose friendship. I don't know. But I know that many of us feel that we're in Lodabar. Nine years ago, I don't know why, but I got diagnosed with MS. Did I eat something bad to get it? No. No one knows what the cause of it is. Maybe that's the reality. I don't know, but I didn't do anything to get it, I don't think. I didn't make poor choices to get it. And the reality of facing something that comes at you that's outside of your own control that causes you to wonder, what the heck is going on? How did I get here? That's a Lodabar experience. But the point is this. The kindness of God is available to me no matter where I am. Your friend Jesus Christ remembers his commitment to you, and his kindness is available. And I want us all to know when in Lodabar, what's our response? So, this chart. When in Lodabar, first, some things to know. First of all, number one, know that he is with you. Hebrews 13:5 quotes Deuteronomy, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And though you may feel, while you're in that desolate, deserted place, that he is not with you, let me tell you that he is. He is right there, waiting and willing to give you all that you need to endure. So when in Lodabar, know that he is with you. Number two, he will bring justice. Know that he will bring justice. The Lord God sees, guys. The Lord God sees. And he keeps watch. And he also keeps score. We don't always get to see justice prevail, but trust me, justice prevails with the Lord God. Isaiah 30, verse 18. Therefore, the Lord waits to be gracious to you, and therefore exalts himself to show mercy to you, for the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him. Isaiah 30:18. When in Lodabar, know that he's with you. Know that he will bring justice. Thirdly, know that he is coming for you. He is coming for you. Just like David sends and calls Mephibosheth to himself, God is coming for you. Isaiah 40, listen to this, 10:11. He's coming for you. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and in his arms rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms, and he will carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those that are with young. So when in Lodabar, we have to know that he's with us, he brings justice, and he's coming for us. But here's the do. What do we do when we're in Lodabar? What do we do when we get hit with MS? What do we do when something is reminding you of the circumstance? We pray. Psalm 17:6, I will call upon you, and you will answer me. We pray when we're in Lodabar. Number two, we get with people. Galatians 6:2, bear one another's burdens, and there fulfill the law of Christ. We have one another when we're in Lodabar. The enemy wants you to get isolated. But God says, no, get with your brother, get with your sister. We pray, we get with people, and then thirdly, we have patience. I'm sorry to tell you here at church today that the God tells you when you're in Lodabar to be patient and to wait on him. Psalm 37:7, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Just like David did not forget Mephibosheth, the Lord God will not forget you. His kindness is there, and know that with every passing day, his kindness is bringing you one step closer to Jerusalem. Do you see it there in the verse? The king said to him, verse 4, where is he? He's in the house of Machir. The king David sent and brought them from the house. And where does he bring them? He brings them to Jerusalem. So point number one, believe it, Harvest Bible Chapel, Crystal Lake. The kindness of God is available to me no matter where I am. Point number two, the kindness of God, it reaches me regardless of who I am. The kindness of God reaches me regardless of who I am. Just let that sink in for a second before I even talk about it and read the scriptures. The kindness of God reaches me regardless of who I am. Look at verse 6. And Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, son of Saul, came to David and fell on his face and paid homage. And David said to Mephibosheth, he said, Mephibosheth. And he answered, behold, I am your servant. And David said to him, do not fear, for I will show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan, and I will restore to you all the land of Saul your father, and you shall eat at my table always. And he paid homage and said, what is your servant that you should show regard for a dead dog such as I? Look at verse 3, by the way, before we get into it. Look at verse 3. Go back up there. See verse 3. Ziba, and the king said, is there not still one of the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of him? Ziba said to the king, there is still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in his feet. Mephibosheth, his identity isn't even in his name there. Ziba doesn't even say his name. He just says he's crippled in his feet. He was labeled. He's the crippled guy. The crippled guy is still alive. The crippled guy, handicapped, invalid, On top of that, let's talk about his name for a second. Mephibosheth. The name Mephibosheth literally means mouth of shame. So every time someone calls him his name, he's reminded of shame. You're an embarrassment. You're worthless. You're helpless. You're hopeless. Add to that that the practice of the day regarding war, I mentioned it earlier, when a king conquered another king, it was customary to wipe out every single member of the family of the king that was conquered. Why? To prevent any uprisings, any way that any of the descendants of the former king could ever come back and vie for power. So Mephibosheth has a target on his back. He's been in Lodabar for 20 to 30 years, knowing there's a target always on his back. When's the day? They're coming after me. Then you even look at verse 8. He even understands it. I'm a dead dog. I'm a dog. And not only a dog, he says of himself, I'm a dead dog. I feel bad for the way Mephibosheth had to go through life. You and I, we are Mephibosheth. Crippled by the reality of sin after sin. We are hopeless and we are helpless and we are lame. Sin cripples us. We walk with the limp, unable to heal ourselves from our fatal deformity. Like Mephibosheth describes himself in verse 8, you and I, because of who we are in the sinfulness of my life and yours, we are nothing more than dead dogs. Filled with shame, sinfulness. So when we come into the presence of a mighty, holy God, like Mephibosheth, we should cower in fear. But, see my smile? But God, in his amazing love and loving kindness, reaches out to me and you in spite of my ugly, crippled, sinful state and says, do not fear. Come as you are. For the sake of my son Jesus and your professed friendship to him, I call you my child, no longer my enemy, but now my beloved son or daughter. Do not fear. My perfect love will cast it out. Wow. In the 18th century, a man named Napoleon rose to power in France. And he was the most powerful man in the world. A young man had committed a serious crime and was standing before Napoleon for judgment. And his mother asked to speak, and she pleaded for his pardon. The emperor said it was a second offense, and justice demanded his death. But the mom said, I don't ask for justice. I plead for mercy. But Napoleon said, he does not deserve mercy. And the mom said, sire, it would not be mercy if he deserved it. And mercy is all I ask for. Moved by the mother's plea, Napoleon said, well, I will have mercy. and her son was saved. We don't deserve pardon either. But the kindness of the Lord reaches past who I am. Turn over to Titus. In the New Testament, Paul's last letter. I want to read Titus chapter 3, verse 3 to 8. I want you to hear the kindness of the Lord. For we ourselves were once foolish, verse 3 of chapter 3, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. Verse 4, here we go. Can't even wait to read it for you guys. But when the goodness and loving, say the word, say it louder.
Kindness.
But when the goodness and the loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy by the washing of regeneration, renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. And God, it feels like God was inspiring Titus to write that passage to relate to Mephibosheth and what David did. God reaches you regardless of who you are. Your place and your past do not determine your future. God's kindness reaches through your desolation, through your shame, and through your pain. And God says who you are, not your own thoughts about yourself and not what the world says about you. Hear that? Let me say that again. God says, Crystal Lake, who you are, not even what your own thoughts think and not what the world says about you. The world says you're broken, but God says you're restored. The world says you're lost, but God says you're found. The world would say maybe you're a slave, but God says you're free. The world says you're an outcast, but God says you're redeemed. The world says you're shameful, but God says you're my son. The world says you might be destitute, but God says, you're my daughter. The world says you could be an enemy, but God says you're part of a family. Point number two was God's kindness reaches me regardless of who I am. Praise be to God, amen? Third point and last, God's kindness, it's extravagant towards me because of who he is. God's kindness, it's extravagant towards me because of who he is. Let's read 9 to 13. Then the king called Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, all that belonged to Saul and to all his house I have given to your master's grandson. And you and your sons and your servants shall till the land for him and shall bring in the produce that your master's grandsons may have bread to eat. But Mephibosheth, your master's grandson shall always eat at my table. Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, according to all that my lord the king commands his servant, so will your servant do. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. And Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah. And all who lived in Ziba's house became Mephibosheth's servants. So Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem, for he ate always at the king's table. Now he was lame in both of his feet. I want you to see that David's kindness to Mephibosheth was not miserly. Easily, David could have kept his promise by just saying to Mephibosheth, I am going to let you live and show you kindness, for I should kill you. But David doesn't say, I'm just going to spare your life. He brings him home. He pays for his moving expenses. He gives him his grandfather's land and estate. He gives him all of his grandfather's servants to work the land. And he gets to eat every night at the royal table. And look at the verse there. That's verse 11 at the end of it. Like one of the king's sons. The kindness is extravagant. It's overflowing. David just doesn't save him. He blesses him profusely. I'm not just going to save you, David said. I'm going to abundantly, graciously, tangibly bless you. God's kindness means no fear. We talked about that. It means restoration. And it means he has a place at his table for you. Verse 11b, I love it. At the very end, Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's son. The table. There's so much richness in all of this. The table is a picture of provision. We're going to eat at the Lord's table at the great marriage supper of the Lamb someday. There is a table, and it's a symbol of God's provision. All his needs, Mephibosheth's needs, are going to be provided for. It's a picture of abundance. Because when you come to the table, do you think David's table ever runs out of food? Do you think the king's table ever ran out of food? Do you think it had like stinky, rotten grapes? Or do you think every time they were lush and amazing? What do you think, Si? They were pretty amazing. It doesn't just talk about meeting needs. It's like, we're going to meet your needs and more. It's also a picture of intimacy. How many of you have ever, when you were little, sat at the kids' table at Thanksgiving? Okay, a lot of you know what I'm talking about, right? You have the kids' table, and then you have the grown-ups, because there's so many people. Like, we have, like, I don't know, my parents do Thanksgiving, and there's, like, I don't know, 20-some maybe there, and there's not room at the big table, so you got to have the kids' table. Some of my kids love the kids' table, by the way. They don't want to be at the big table, but this is not the kids' table. David is calling Mephibosheth to his table. It's a picture of intimacy. What do you do around the table? You share your life with each other. You talk to each other. How was your day? What did God do in your life today? It's a picture of intimacy. David wants to have a relationship. He just doesn't want to save him. He wants to have a relationship with Mephibosheth. Why am I telling you this? Because this is what God wants with you. He invites you to his table and wants a relationship with you. God is not a God of the pages of a Bible. The Lord God is a living person in the person of Jesus Christ, and he calls us to a love relationship, and he wants you to be at his table and sit next to him and share your thoughts, your concerns. He wants to feed you and give you what you need. He wants to love you, and he wants you to love him. He wants a relationship, and God, like David, the King of Kings, is inviting you to his table, not only to provide for you, not only to give you so much more than you ever could imagine in abundance, but to have an intimate relationship with himself. It's unbelievable that the creator of the world, who spoke it into existence, being so supremely powerful, yet so supremely relational. It's awesome. What a picture. God wants to show this kind of extravagant kindness to you. And some of you here may be saying today that I want this kind of kindness in my life, but I don't know how to get it. You can have it today. You can have it today. If you've never seen Jesus Christ and the extravagant kindness that he's given to you on his death and burial on the cross, it's available. His kindness to save you from a dog's death to eternal life at his table with abundance. Not just the future in heaven, but abundance even now. God's kindness is available to me no matter where I am. God's kindness reaches me regardless of who I am. And God's kindness, it's extravagant towards me because of who he is. I want you to close your eyes right now. We're going to close a little bit longer close. I'm going to speak to three different kinds of people and pray for you if you're in any one of these categories. Whether you're in one of these categories now, maybe not, but likely you're going to be at some point. So here's the first group. When Mephibosheth looked around in Lodebar, all he saw was his circumstances. How did I get here? I'm feeling so alone. I'm feeling confused and lost, void of hope. If you're in Lodebar today, in the midst of a dry, desolate, difficult land, I want you to have some courage right now and just raise your hand. Everybody's looking down and praying. Raise your hand if you're in Lodebar, if you've got something going on in your life that's hard and you don't understand why. I see your hands. Thank you for raising them. I want to pray for those now that have their hands up. Oh God, these people that are in a hard place, God, in a barren and dry place. Oh God, thank you that your loving kindness is there. Oh God, you're with them and you will bring justice. And you are drawing them to yourself. They will not always be in Lodebar, God. Help them to wait patiently and expectantly and triumphantly, even in the desert, trusting in you. The kindness of the Lord, their King is coming. Jerusalem is near. We don't know how, we don't know when, but their King and his kindness are as sure as the dawn. Thank you, God. I want to pray for a second group of people. When Mephibosheth looked in the mirror, all he saw was a reminder of his sad state. When people said his name, it reminded him of his own shame. He was a fugitive and an enemy of the reigning king. And maybe somebody here, when they look in the mirror, all they can see is their past failures, haunted by poor choices of the past. And all they see is the shortcomings, failures, and sins. If you struggle with that, I want you to raise your hand. Struggling with the past and things that you've done and shame. I see your hands. I see your hands. Oh gosh, I'm so glad that God is so good. He doesn't want you to feel that way. The Lord God loves you. And he's forgiven that. If you know Jesus Christ, he's forgiven that. And he remembers them no more. And oh God, I pray for those people that they would see themselves as you see them. certainly sinners, but saved by your grace and loved by a God who is so kind and so gentle and longing for them to shed that, Lord, and run to you in repentance and receiving forgiveness and joy. Let's repent and turn, that times of refreshing may come in the presence of the Lord. Oh God, would you refresh those people and help them see how good and how loving and accepting you are. For we're all not worthy, but oh God, your mercy overcomes it. Thank you, God. The last set of people I want to pray for here today is for anyone who has never received or accepted the kindness of the Lord. They maybe never understood it before, how great a lengths God has gone to be kind to us when he sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross. If you've never received that kindness, I want to give you an opportunity now. If that's you, raise your hand and I want to pray for you. You've never received the kindness of the Lord through Jesus Christ, the great gift that he's given to you and his son. I want to pray for you. Anyone? One thing I love about calling people to give their life to Jesus Christ, when no one raises their hand, it makes me super happy. Why? Because I believe that in your heart, you are sure that you have Jesus Christ as your Savior. And today, when you walk out of this door, you are sure you're going to be at the table in heaven. And if that's the case of the 400 people in this room, oh God, it's awesome. But if you're not sure, I want to give you one more chance to raise your hand and let me pray for you so that you might know that Jesus Christ is the kindness of God sent to you, the living God. Oh God, we thank you so much for your Son. We are here to glorify and to worship your great Son, and we are so blessed, and we receive your kindness today, and we thank you for how you pour it out on us daily, day after day. You're so good to us. Oh God, thank you that your kindness reaches us no matter where we are, no matter who we are. And it's because of who you are, not because of who we are. And we give you all the praise and glory for that. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this actual event in history where David demonstrated to a man named Mephibosheth what you extend to all of us in your son, Jesus. We love you. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.